43 of the Before the Train Wreck series. And I got a special guest tonight. We're joined by Dr. Robert Glover. How you doing, Rob?
I'm good. Good to see you guys again.
Good. And of course, we've got the doctor, Sean T. Smith.
That's the one. You and I haven't talked for about a month.
Yeah. Our last episode was the paternity fraud one that we did on, I think it was early December. December 4th or something like that, which is coming up on the year. It was like the year anniversary of our first show ever.
Yeah.
So we got a lot to talk about tonight. We got some stuff to catch up on before we hop into the good Dr. Glover's new book and the stuff that he's going to dive into. I wanted to ask you about your truck, Sean. You just been posting about this pretty sexy, fancy white Tacoma you got. What do you think about that?
I love it. It's just a wonderful truck. It's not like I'm boasting, but it's the top of the line. The only reason I say that is because it has a very finely tuned suspension. And I've had other four-wheel drive trucks before. I've never ridden in a suspension that is tuned as finely as this one is. I'm ignoring speed bumps. I just go straight over them, potholes. I don't care. I haven't taken it any place interesting yet, but I'm really looking forward to actually getting it off the road.
So is this like a Fox-tuned off-road, we're going to drive up the Colorado mountains sort of suspension?
Yeah, that's the one.
Nice. How does it compare to the Raptor? Because I've been looking at those for the last couple of years. It's a real big truck, though.
It's not huge. It's called a midsize. But you know, when you and I were coming up, when all three of us were coming up, a midsize truck was small. Like the old Nissan trucks were very small trucks. They had one bench seat in the front, and they had like a 6-foot bed, and they were like small cars. And now a midsize truck is what a large pickup was back then. So yeah, I guess it's big by those standards.
And you're a big guy. I mean, you're at least as tall as I am from what I remember when we were standing side by side. I mean, like, do you fit in it comfortably?
Yeah. Yeah. No problems.
How's the head getting in? I test drove one, and that was my biggest complaint. You can't adjust the seats, and they got a real low profile when you get in the door.
Oh, it's a low roof line.
I haven't hit my head yet, but give me time.
All right.
It'll happen, right? You know, it's funny because you're in Mexico, Robert.
Do
you have a lot of white off-road pickup trucks down there? Because somebody made a joke the other day when I was talking about buying a truck. They're like, well, you know, we can go and get some Mexicans to go do some work for us too when we drive by the corner.
Yeah, I think if I was going to get a Toyota Tundra, I'd only get a silver one personally, but you know,
gotta be silver.
Yeah, I'd go silver.
So
in the Toyota dealer down here is right across the street from Home Depot. So, you know, you can just get your truck and go right by Home Depot and, you know, get as many workers as you need right there.
Sweet. Get it all done in one shot. So you got a new book.
Yeah, it's been out in June. We're talking the following January. Came out in June, Dating Essentials for Men. It's a compilation of four online classes I taught for about 10 years. Mm-hmm. This a compilation of what I learned when I became single in my late 40s after 25 years of marriage, and I had no friggin' clue how to date. So that's where that came from.
And for those of you that don't know who our guest is tonight, you should know who he is. Dr. Robert Glover wrote No More Mr. Nice Guy, which was one of the first books I think that were recommended to me when I started kind of pivoting into talking about stuff to deal with the sexual marketplace and attraction and arousal and all that. I wasn't really sure what it was all about. They just said, you got to read Dr. Glover's No More Mr. Nice Guy. And I grabbed it and I listened to it and I thought it was great. And then I met you probably about 2 years later in person. You know, we've chatted since. But this new book kind of takes your bestseller, your hit, to a new level. Why? Can you kind of explain a little bit of that?
Well, you know, I write about what I struggle with, and I am a recovering nice guy. I mean, that was my story. I tell people that No More Mr. Nice Guy is autobiographical. I just use other people's stories to tell my own. And I often say it's not a record of my successes. It's a tale of my fuck-ups. You know, just learning over and over again what doesn't work. I'm like most nice guys. I'm a slow learner and a quick forgetter. But I had a PhD in marriage and family therapy at 29 years old, and it gave me actually really no clue how to be married, or, you know, how to run a business, or, you know, how to just live life very well. So I've, like most people, I've just kind of had to learn that as I go. And for whatever reason, I tend to, whatever I struggle with, I then communicate about it. I write about it. I teach about it. And so, as I said, when I got divorced in my late 40s after 25 years of marriage, two marriages, I hadn't dated since high school and college, and I sucked at it back then. And so I thought, if I'm going to do anything different than I did in my first two marriages, I better learn how to become a better picker and learn how to become a better ender. And so I went out. I mean, I got, you know, my clients kept giving me different, you know, books and CDs, you know, Double Your Dating, David D'Angelo. About that time, The Game came out with Neil Strauss. And, you know, I just read and listened, and I just went out and just practiced stuff. And I quickly found out I didn't like the whole pickup approach to things, but you know, there's some good tips and tools in there. But I basically, looking back on it now, I just really worked at becoming a social animal and just developed social skills and got bold and, you know, just decided to interact more boldly with people. And what surprised me most, all my adult life, I thought, well, women aren't really attracted to me. Especially attractive women aren't attractive to me, which is kind of interesting because my second wife was beautiful. But I still had that mindset. And I also had this mindset that women don't like sex and they think men who want to have sex with them are bad. So by the time I got out there in my 40s, I'd kind of overcome some of those self-limiting beliefs. They were still there and had to challenge them a lot. But what amazed me is when I got out and just started interacting with people and being bolder and walking through open doors, I started wondering what planet I'd landed on. Women were coming on to me. They were hitting on me. They were propositioning me for sex. They're saying, I don't want to date. I just need to get laid. Women are getting naked on first and second dates without me even pushing it in that direction. So I thought, well, this is, you know, a hell of a lot easier than I thought it was. And then my clients noticed I was dating a lot and getting laid a lot. So they said, teach us. I said, well, I don't know anything. I'm not a dating guru, but I guess none of us were dating gurus till we maybe learned how to do it. And then we became dating gurus.
Let me ask you this question. You've said before that you're not big on pickup, or you're not fond of it. I can't remember what you said the first time, but it was something around that same sort of sound. But yeah. Why is that?
A few reasons.
And maybe define what your version of pickup is. Okay. Like, is that pickup artistry, like the conventional approaching three dozen women in an open space and try to get the number sort of thing? Or like, what do you see as like pickup artistry?
Yeah, you know, I'm going to make some generalizations, and I know I'll probably piss off a lot of people and offend a few people. That's okay.
We like to do that here.
Yeah, let's go for it. A few reasons why I'm not a big fan of just approaching someone because you think she's hot. Number one, I can't think of actually a worse foundation to build any kind of relationship with a woman on, just basing it on her physical appearance. You know, we men have this kind of porn-based fantasy that if a woman's attractive, she's going to be great. She's going to be fun. She's going to be interesting. She's going to treat us well. She's going to be in good in bed, which is one of the biggest myths personally that I've discovered, is that the best looking women I've been with were terrible. They don't have to be good in bed. Most of them have been abused their entire lives, and you know, they got issues. So just basing, I want to be, and guys ask me that all the time. They say, well, you know, how do I see this woman I like. How do I get her to like me? I said, what are you talking about? And they say, well, they said, you know, I see this woman and she's hot and I want to talk to her and I want her to, you know, go out with me and give me a number. And I'll say, well, you don't even know anything about her. You're going to approach her just because physically, you know, she turns you on and that's good for your ego. And you think your friends will be impressed and you have an illusion she'll be good in bed. And I said, you can do that. But number one is fundamentally invasive. Is I think it's actually pretty shallow to just say, I'm going to approach women just because they're hot. It'd be like women saying, I only want to date rich guys. We guys think that's shallow. We you know, we call women names that do that. But I just want a hot woman. So it's fundamentally invasive. I think it's the reason for a lot of the whole hashtag Me Too is men just kind of blindly pursuing women that aren't sending them any signals of interest. But the bottom line is it's too much fucking hard work. I would rather walk through open doors of women that are already showing high interest in me than just keep pounding on a closed door, hoping it will open just because I think she's hot. Yeah. And I what I found is that once I became comfortable in my own skin and more of a social animal, there were doors opening up all around me. Women of all ages, all types, all the way from women my mother's age to 18-year-old daughters of friends of mine that were letting it be known to get with me. And I mean, and everything in between. And I know a lot
of
guys.
The last time we had you on, you said something along the lines of choose women that choose you. I don't know if you remember that, yeah, Sean, but that was like one of the big sound bites that really stood out to me.
Yeah.
I stole that from David Data. I heard him say that. And when I first heard it, it was a little confusing until it wasn't anymore. And then it dawned on me, you know, that's kind of the entire premise that I've tried to get with women that haven't chosen me. And if you think about it, you know, kind of out there in the manosphere, they talk a lot about alphas and betas, which I don't really like the terms applied to men. I think it's kind of just men one-upping and one-downing each other, which I'm not sure it serves us. But if you actually think about it, if you're approaching a woman trying to get her to notice you and like you, she's the alpha, you're the beta, you're the one down supplicating for her attention and approval. And if a woman already thinks you're interesting and already has some desire to be with you, you're actually the alpha. She wants your approval. And it lets you be the decider. When you approach women and try to get them to give you a number or get them to go out with you, they're the decider. They've got all the power. And that's why guys get rejected so much. You know, maybe you can go out and get a lot of numbers. I got good at getting numbers, but numbers don't get you laid. I'd rather be with someone that's showing high interest. And then the common comeback from a lot of guys is, well, but you know, I only want to be with this type of woman. I don't want a woman older than me or a woman that's fatter than me. And it's kind of like saying, if I can't drive a Bentley, I'm not going to drive at all. And I know you drive nice cars, Rich, and you know, that's great, but you didn't start out the very first car you drove, I'm sure, being a Bentley. You know,
nope.
Another way to put it,
he wasn't fat though either.
Well, and I'm not saying, you know, I do often say you got to fuck a few fatties, but that's a metaphor, meaning that maybe they're not all going to be tens. But again, some of the most fun, interesting women I've ever been with were not women that initially would have turned my head because they were tens.
Yeah.
I'm saying it's just, I've been with a lot of amazing women in my lifetime and had a lot of great sex by following that philosophy of choosing a woman who chooses you.
Yeah, yeah. Sean, I feel like I'm monopolizing Robert's time here.
No, not at all. But, you know, we should say the name of the book, which it's called Dating Essentials for Men. I don't think we
I didn't get that blurb out already. No. Dating Essentials for Men. Go to Amazon.
Yeah. It's where you can find the books.
Yeah. If you're watching this on YouTube, it's linked in the top comment. It's pinned there, the Amazon store. So Dr. Glover's books are there. Dr. Smith's books are there, along with many others. I'm going to do a full breakdown of my entire recommended reading list, but I just added your book in there as well, Dr. Glover. Sean, what do you have for the man that you once said, you know, Robert Glover's, he's not a nice guy, but he's a kind man.
Yeah,
I introduced him, right?
Yeah, I quoted him on that later and said, yeah, the guy who said that bought me dinner the night before. So I think he's a kinder man.
I like this book a lot. And one of the things, I've got some notes here to go through, so I'm kind of jumping around here. And Robert, I actually came up with something that's very unfair. I came up with a little three-question quiz about your book. So maybe we can get to that. But
do I have to answer the quiz?
Yeah, okay. If you want to. And I realize that's unfair because if you asked me what I said this morning, I wouldn't be able to remember it. But one of the things that I like about this book just globally is, and there's a lot to like you give guys specific things to do to get them out of their anxiety. But this is kind of an anxiety book underneath it all, because what you're talking about throughout a lot of this book is the anxieties and the limiting beliefs that men have about women. And when I started out as a psychologist, like 15, 16, 18 years ago, whenever it was, I worked a lot with anxiety and I got pretty good in anxiety. And when you're treating an anxiety conditions, one of the things that you have to do is you have to do what's called a behavioral analysis. You have to identify, first of all, what is the target of the anxiety? And sometimes that's kind of tricky to identify. But once you identify what the target is, the thing that triggers the anxiety, then that's what you go after, right? And you go after it with a very detailed, organized plan. Mm-hmm. And this book gives guys a very detailed, organized plan for tackling this anxiety. And I would bet money that if a guy follows these guidelines that you've given them, if they've got some other anxiety in their life, which we all do at some point, that the skills you give them here are going to generalize into any other area where they're having some kind of anxiety.
You're exactly right. And, you know, even to kind of take it back and then move it forward, I often say that nice guy syndrome is an anxiety-based disorder. And so by me learning this example for the date, it did help me a lot with my generalized anxieties that I'd carried around since youth, since a child. And as I learned to soothe my anxieties around dating, interacting with women, my business grew, my income went up, my life got better, opportunities came. It changed my entire life. And so what I've been saying for years is dating essentials for men really is not about teaching men how to date. It's teaching men social skills. It's expanding their emotional and social intelligence by using something that's important to them that will motivate them enough to want to expand their social and emotional intelligence. And that is having a girlfriend or getting laid. Those are important things to most men. And as you say, if you have a lot of anxiety about looking foolish, getting rejected, getting trapped, getting smothered, being found out, being cheated on, you're going to be passive. And so if you can learn to soothe the anxieties around all of those things, you can be a lot more assertive. You can be a lot bolder. You can take more risks. You can walk through more open doors.
Chapter 7 is really good in that regard. You lay out several myths that a lot of guys walk around in their head, within their head about women. Like one myth is that women are inherently superior to men. You remember that one? You know what I'm talking about here?
Yeah.
And what's the answer to that? The answer is that they're flawed human beings.
They're flawed human beings. We're all flawed human beings. And, you know, as a psychologist, you know, when we can learn to just accept ourselves, you know, warts and all, life gets easier. We get comfortable in our own skin. We actually get more attractive. I mean, one of the most interesting things I've ever done in groups I've been in and groups I've led, for example, is asking men to share with each other the thing I most don't want you to know about me, you know, the things we keep that we have shame and anxiety and fear about. And it's funny, once you start sharing these things, people actually start liking you better. You become more attractive and more interesting.
Yeah.
And so we need to accept who we are. Now, the one of the points that I make, you know, the point you're referencing to about women is we men put women up on a pedestal, especially mm-hmm. attractive women. You know, if they're not fat, if they're younger than us and not ugly, we put them on a pedestal. And we think that that's again, trying to get their favor, getting them to choose us. And we think we got to be so perfect. You know, Rich, you made a reference last time about the sixes. What was it? Six figure income, six pack, 6 foot tall, and 6,000 horsepower car or something like that.
600 horsepower car. Yeah, that was a list.
No, I want the 6,000 horsepower
car. You can have 6,000 if you want it. You know, you can do whatever you want, man. You're a grown ass adult. Buy whatever you want, right? That's what I say.
But so many men think, all right, I got to have all of that stuff going on for a woman to be interested in me. But the point that I make in the book, and I've been teaching guys, in our culture, women, from the time they're little girls, just tiny little girls, they get judged by their physical appearance. Mm-hmm. And they grow up thinking that, everybody's liberated. Yeah. But every woman I know still wants to be pretty and still wants to look good and still wants to think they're attractive. And every woman I know can look around and find other women who are more attractive than them, subjectively. Mm-hmm. And that's where women get their identity. And, you know, women have more depression than men in general. They got more mood disorders than men. They got more insecurities than men. And so I make that point not to be at all dismissive of women, but to try to get guys out of their head thinking that I do have to have the six-pack abs and a six-inch dick and 6 foot tall and a six-figure income or eight-inch dick to get a woman to be interested in me. You don't. We just have to learn to accept ourselves and become more socially confident.
So, Robert, here's another myth from that same chapter that I think could really help insecure guys calm down around women. The myth is that women are complicated. And do you remember what your fact was about that?
What the fact was?
The fact versus the myth. Myth is that women are complicated. The fact is that women are security seeking creatures.
Yeah,
and it's not really that complicated.
I've been saying that for years. I tell guys, if a woman's doing something you can't understand, it is probably either that she's feeling insecure, her trust has been breached in some way, or she's having a bad hair day, or it's that time of month. But what happens is because we men tend to buy into women's reality. Why? Because we want them to like us and want to be with us. We start buying into their reality and they get complicated. But they're, as a psychologist, I know this isn't popular to talk about in some areas, but the female brain physically is structured differently than a male brain. And it's actually a positive thing that they have more access to the two hemispheres of their brain. Their rational and emotional brain are more connected than in a male brain. We tend to be kind of one-sided in our brains. Now, that makes them more global in how they can see the world, but it also does tend to make them a little bit more where their reason is more influenced by their emotion than we men are.
If you had told me when I was 18 that women are security-seeking creatures, it would have changed my entire world.
I have a slightly different take on the security seeking creatures, and it came from Carl. So I want to give credit where credit's due. Black Label Logic, you guys are probably familiar with him from some of the collabs we've done on Rule Zero recently. And he put out a blog after he was off for a little bit, and he closed it with, quite frankly, there's a limit to how many times you can repeat, women chase the best deal, men prioritize availability over price and quality. I thought he summed up the sexual marketplace quite brilliantly with that phrase. I'll say it again.
I'm letting that sink in.
Yeah, here, I'm going to copy and paste it into the chat just so everybody can see it. But women chase the best deal. Men prioritize availability over price and quality.
The way I've always thought it, and this may be the same thing, I'm having to let that sink in, exactly what I say, that, a man walks into a room and he looks around and says, what are my choices? A woman walks into the room, looks around, says, who's my competition?
She's looking at the other women,
but
women will chase the best deal, and men, generally speaking, prioritize availability over price and quality.
How do we define it?
He was cracking a joke out of it, yeah.
Yeah.
What's the best deal? How do we define that?
Yeah, for women, what's the best deal?
What's the best deal is the best they can get. I mean, their hypergamy is forcing them to ask, is this the best I can do, right?
But what if hypergamy doesn't exist? What if that's a myth?
All right, let's go down that rabbit hole. Let's talk about that. Hang on a second. We're going to give you the full screen. Dive into it, Dr. Glover.
the hypergamy full screen.
Let's go.
Okay. I think evolutionary psychologists have mixed up their apples and oranges, is my theory. There's good evidence that humans have existed in a tribal context, 1.5 million, 2 million years, where everything was communal, including sex, food, everything that was needed. Now, I'm not saying that because there was scarcity, there might not have been competition, because that competition between women for the scarce resource, i.e. they walk into a room, who's my competition for the attention of the men that are here? I do think it's built into their evolutionary DNA, but I don't know that there was anything to trade up to in our tribal existence. I mean, everybody, the younger women might have gotten more attention than the 15 and 16 year olds did. They were dog meat by the time they were 16 or 17. But I don't think that we didn't have this kind of, pair bonded monogamous structure for millions of years. pair bonding has only existed for less than 10,000 years. And the same evolutionary psychologists say it takes about 20,000 years to develop an evolutionary trait. And so I think hypergamy doesn't really serve a purpose other than it lets people, guys on the internet, sound smart. Look at most women. Most don't trade up. Most women go for losers. That's been my experience. Look around. Women, you know, women sleep with fat men, women in prison, men with man buns, you know, women sleep with those guys. I don't see women trading up all that much. Show me the evidence of women trading up in any kind of consistent way. I don't think most women have the combination of good looks, intelligence, and a Machiavellian mindset to just go out and keep trading up. I think there's a few that are gold diggers, but I don't think in general women are looking around to trade up.
Okay, so when you say women chase the best deal, we're not just talking about...
Well, I didn't say that. Somebody else said that.
Well, that's really what hypergamy, you know, boils down to. But if she's chasing the best deal, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's the guy with the most money, the nicest car, the nicest house. I mean, to a woman, if she's in a phase of her life where it's really just about validational sex with the alpha, the best deal might be the guy that's in prison. Like, we see all these women that are on these dating sites to go out with inmates, right? Or to go and have conjugal visits with it.
There's dating sites for that.
I'm not even kidding, right? So, you know, getting the best deal for them can be different depending on what phase of the life that they're in. So it doesn't necessarily boil down to financial resources.
Okay, I think that's a better way to put it, is getting the best deal. But I've been a marriage therapist.
It's the best deal for them.
Okay, and I can buy into that concept. Yeah. But as a marriage therapist for over 30 years, I've seen men and women both cheat. You know, men tend to go for, you know, the younger yoga instructor type, you know, and women maybe leave their husband to marry their boss, the dentist, the attorney, or whatever. But I see women leaving their dentist, you know, attorney husbands all the time. I've just not seen hypergamy consistently play out in the bigger population of women from my point of view. And all I've really seen it do is, again, help men sound smart while they stay pissed off at women because the women are always trading up. I just don't see that as a general thing women do.
Okay.
This is my perspective. Sean, I get that makes me stand out in the whole manosphere.
It does, yeah, it does, yeah.
Yeah. I've been working on a video for a couple of months now, and a few months, actually. I've really been digging into this hypergamy idea from the red pill perspective and from evolutionary psychology and from my own clinical practice. And I'm hoping to have it out here in the next month or so. It's really turned into kind of a monster of a project, but I'll give you my tentative conclusion from what I found so far, that it seems to me that hypergamy, in the original definition, this goes back to 1881 in a census that was done in India. There was a guy who was doing a census, and he noticed that in this Hindu caste system, family could increase its status and move up the hierarchy by marrying their daughter to someone in the next level or a higher level of the caste system. And so this census taker needed a word to describe that particular thing that was going on in the caste system. And so he came up with hypergamy. And it has kind of stuck around for a while, and it became a term in the social sciences that was very rarely used, but essentially is a specific term for women that talks about a woman wanting to marry someone who is at a higher level than her. And that gets very messy when you step outside of a caste system. But here's the conclusion that I'm slowly coming to, which is that hypergamy, if it's a female-specific concept, yes, it has a certain amount of power to drive the choices that women make in relationships. It's an important factor. But I'm kind of like Robert. I'm not seeing any evidence that hypergamy has the power to end relationships. And that's one of the big arguments of the red pill community. And I'm just not finding the support for it. But as I said, I will say a lot more in a video that I've got coming out here before too long.
I want to kind of orbit around this topic a little bit longer because this is getting interesting. So
I'm having
Dr.
fun.
Glover. Yeah, no, totally. Like I don't want this to sound like an echo chamber where we all say the same thing. So Dr. Glover says that you haven't seen any evidence that it exists through your practice, you know, what you've looked at. And Sean, I don't want to misquote you, but you're not seeing evidence of it either.
I'm not. I'm seeing evidence of hypergamy starting relationships, but I'm not seeing evidence of it ending relationships.
So if, and I mean, like, you guys are in a clinical practice, so you talk to way more people that are coming to you guys. Like, people talk to me like they book me for coaching because they're getting divorced and they want to get out without too much collateral damage. Or if they're vetting somebody or something like that, or if it's a business call. But as far as marriage counseling, I don't do that. I'd never do that. I'm not qualified to have any kind of conversations around that. But here's what I find interesting, though. It's, you know, whenever I talk to a guy that has had issues with his relationship with his wife, with his LTR, he's thinking about taking her back. He's thinking about going back to the marriage. And she left the marriage, or she went outside of it. It's always because of hypergamy. It's always because he wasn't the best deal that she could get. And I've often said that, you know, when guys start to relax and they get lazy and they stop chasing excellence, then their value is going to go down in the eyes of their partner. Mm-hmm. And if she feels like her value is higher and she can do better, then that's when she starts looking elsewhere. That's when the radar, you know, that's when the clock starts ticking. It's the whole tick tock, tick tock. You know, it's ticking down at some point. It may never end, but it starts ticking, right? She'll start to, signal and demonstrate dissatisfaction. You know, she'll start to chirp on him a little bit more, nag him a little bit more. She might choose to go out during the during the peak of her ovulation cycle, sort of thing, and she's going out with her girlfriends with a little black dress on, you know, because it's girls' night out. But it always seems to happen at the same time every single month. So I've seen a lot of evidence that it does exist from that sense. So I'm a little bit confused from the perspective that both of you guys are taking at it from that clinical angle. It's right. It's different.
I'll jump in for a second. I agree really strongly with one thing you said very specifically, is when men quit chasing excellence. Yep. I like that term. I like how you put that. All the way from the work I'd done for 30 years as a marriage therapist to being on my third marriage, to learning how to date, to teaching men how to date. I'm a strong believer that if a man is being his best person, challenging himself, growing, I think that is, for lack of a better way to put it, that's sexy as hell. That is attractive to all things feminine, right? And that was what I experienced when I got out after my divorce. I got out and I was challenging myself in every which way, going through some struggles, but just, for me, the struggles were a challenge. They were an opportunity to grow. And I found that in that space, that made me amazingly attractive to the feminine. Didn't even have to work at attracting it. And I agree with you. And this is the premise of the book I'm working on right now. The next book that around, I think probably mentioned it before, around what I call positive emotional tension. I believe that women have to experience emotional tension with a man to be attracted to him, to be sexually aroused by him, and to stay connected to him over time. I think what happens in many, many marriages, now a lot of marriages, people are just immature, toxic, addicted, bad personality disorders, you know, relationship trauma. I mean, the fact that we try to do, you know, long-term monogamous relationships and expect them to work is, to me, amazes me, because they don't tend to. But what happens, what I think the biggest problem is, and I think one of the biggest fixes for a long-term relationship, is men staying conscious of a woman's need for emotional tension. Now, we men can choose to create what I call positive emotional tension for a woman. And one of the most powerful ways we do that, as you say, is continue to pursue excellence in our life. That doesn't mean chasing the dollar or bigger cars, but it means really challenging ourselves and honing ourselves. That is inherently attractive to females, because that's evolutionary. The most competent, capable men were the ones who survived and protected and provided, whether that's communal or later on, you know, in more of agrarian society, you know, more pair bonded. Women, I think, are attracted to men that, I love your term, Rich, putting a dent in the universe. Mm-hmm. Now, when men quit doing that in their relationship, we all get lazy. When we quit creating that emotional tension, I believe women will create what I call negative emotional tension. That's the nagging, that's the chirping, that's the slamming doors, it's the getting quiet, it's the withdrawing, it's all of that, maybe flirting with his best friend. anything to create emotional tension. Women need the drama. It's, I mean, just look at the TV shows they watch and the movies and the books they read. Mm-hmm. They need the drama. We men hate the drama in our mm-hmm. relationship. So while we're not creating any and we're killing all the negative emotional tension our woman in an LTR is creating, and for us men, getting everything calm and back to good, that's our end game. That's our goal. But then if we're doing that in all areas of life, yeah, that the woman's need for emotional tension is going unmet. Now, in my experience, I'm just going to speak from what I the lenses that I see through. In general, I don't think most women, when that starts dying in a relationship, go out looking for it outside. I think they tend to turn to their kids, their job, to television, to chocolate, to Kardashians and shit like that to get it. But I think that when somebody does show them some attention and creates a little spark, they're like a, you know, a dry forest that they just go like that. They respond to it in a heartbeat.
So, okay, so here's a question that I've got for you, and I want to hear your feedback on it too, Sean, because I've heard you say something along the lines a few times of you've seen women go to heroic lengths to preserve or save a marriage with a guy that's just kind of like, eh, mm-hmm. something along that line. Is that the soundbite?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you've got a couple. Let's say that we'll just use an LTR. It doesn't matter if they're married, living together, whatever. We got a couple, and on a scale of 1 to 10, he's like a 6, and on a scale of 1 to 10, she's like an 8. His value's gone down over time, let's say.
Now we're talking more than just physical features. We're talking about just that their
stay with me here. Okay. Stay with me here. I'm going to walk you through the story. So let's say his value is a couple points lower than what it was when they got together. You know, he's gotten fat. He spent a lot more time sitting on the couch watching TV. He's got Cheeto dust on his chin when he goes to bed at night. You know, he's turned into a bit of a slob sort of thing. He's not been promoted. She's got 3 promotions, or she's advanced in her career. She's done a lot better. She's driving a nicer car now. She's paying for most of the household improvements, and he's just kind of toeing the line, you know, steady as he goes sort of thing. But she's gotten considerably better. She's also gotten a nicer body. She's gone to yoga. She's taking care of herself. Maybe gravity set in. She got her boobs done and fixed up sort of thing. Her value's gone up. So in her eyes, she's seen her value go up. Mm-hmm. His value's either stayed the same or gone down. In this case, it's gone down just because he's lost his you know, his edge. You know, he stopped chasing excellence, got fat, sort of stuff like that. Hasn't really, you know, pursued better money, a higher paying job, more social recognition, for example. Women like that leave guys routinely. And it's these guys that I've had coaching calls with that they're like, okay, I'm going through a divorce. This is what happened. And then we kind of get into his story. But it's always interesting to note that there's a common denominator in these breakups where she ended up banging somebody else or got involved with somebody else or, you know, had the conversation with him along the lines of something like, I love you, but I'm not in love with you. Right. So what is that if that's not hypergamy? What is that if she's not leaving him for somebody else? I'm like, that's what I'm confused with right now. Like, what do you call that?
Who wants to go first?
I'll let you go, Sean. I've been yakking.
Fire away. Solo layup. Boom. Right.
Let me gather my thought here. I'm gonna qualify it at the outset by saying that the people who come to my office are self-selected and they're not entirely representative of the population. So, Rich, I think you and I talk to different groups of people. People come to me when at least one of them has been able to persuade the other one that we need to fix things. And it's usually the woman who's persuading the man that we need to fix things. Surprisingly, I would say probably about 40% of the time it's the man bringing the woman in, which is a smart thing to do. Like, you should be taking the lead in the relationship, which is actually one of the things that Robert points out in this new book, is taking the lead and setting the tone. But so you and I probably are talking to different crowds of men. You're talking to guys who are after the train wreck. I'm talking to guys who are before the train wreck, mm-hmm. more or less. And the reason I wouldn't call that hypergamy, the scenario that you just described, and you know, maybe we're just getting into semantic differences here, but the reason that I wouldn't call that hypergamy, and I don't, is because it presumes that women are constantly scanning and constantly looking for the better deal. And this is not what everybody in the manosphere says. I don't know that Rolo says that. But if you go into comment sections, like you go into YouTube comments and you go into some forums and so forth, this is what you're going to see, this paranoia mm-hmm. that women are always scanning and always looking for the, you know, if they're at a 7, they want the 8. And what I see in my practice is that women will actually spend more time trying to resurrect that guy that you just described, the guy who's failing. Mm-hmm. That woman will spend more time trying to resurrect him and put him back together than will his boss or his friends or his brothers and sisters or anyone else in society, because there is a societal expectation. And Roy Baumeister has documented this very well across time and throughout cultures. This societal expectation is that men keep performing. We have that burden of performance. I don't consider it a burden. I consider it a blessing, but we have that. And so if the woman is spending more time than anybody else in society trying to prop him back up, I don't see how you call that hypergamy unless the definition of hypergamy is so expansive that it covers everything.
So my question, and this is going to be difficult for you to answer because it's going to rely on you judging their sexual marketplace value and the fact that women are beauty objects. But I mean, if you have I'm just going to say it. If you got a three trying to put back together a four, you know, like, where's she going to go? Like, I've also seen that version of the story too, where you get a guy that's literally depressed, locks himself in his bedroom, doesn't interact with his kids, doesn't get involved with extracurriculars. He's gross, doesn't chase excellence, isn't making money. She hates him. She's constantly complaining to her girlfriends about this guy, but she's a three. Like, she's disgusting. Like, she has no value in the sexual marketplace, right? I've seen that too.
I'm laughing because as you're describing this person, I'm thinking back to you when I grew up in my father's bar, and I saw a lot of threes porking each other. I would venture a guess. I got nothing to back this up, but I would venture to guess that threes and fours, there's a lot more mucking around going on down there than there are in the seven or eights who are trying to hang on to each other.
Yeah, those right, chubby, but I mean, like, what option does a three have on the sexual marketplace to get with Kevin from the sales department or Steve, the vice president of accounting, right?
Well, let me just take your illustration, Rich.
Yeah, go ahead.
Let's just switch it a little bit. I think what you're describing has accuracy to it, but I think you're describing it in terms of just what women do. I think if you just reverse the gender of your story, that you got a guy who's been taking care of himself. He still gets to the gym regularly. He's making good money. His woman's gotten fat. She watches TV. She's into the Kardashians. She says, "Oh my God," all the time. OMG. And you know, she won't read a book. Now he's the seven and she's the four or five. And if he, you know, starts banging, you know, the yoga instructor, we don't call that hypergamy, but we're just describing the exact same trends that, of course, if you got two people, and I don't think it has anything to do with sexual marketplace. I think people want to be happy with their partner and they want their partner to be at their best. And again, so many factors go into long-term relationships and the fact that they inherently, you know, are not part of our DNA and don't work well. I keep trying to do them, but they require a lot of consciousness and they require both people showing up and showing up in all areas of their life. And just because one tends to show up more and one show up less, I don't think it's a gender thing. I don't think it's a male-female thing. I see both sides of it all the time. And the person who's showing up is going to keep trying to get the one who's not to show up. And at some point, they get tired. They get burned out on that. And something better comes along. Doesn't mean they're even out looking for it. A lot of times, something better finds them.
I love that both of you guys are challenging this. And I'm really looking forward to seeing your video. And I'm wondering if maybe we should dedicate an entire session together to kind of talk on this a little bit more. But I really want to go back to Robert's new book.
For sure.
And I want to hit on the super chat real quick here. CW, thanks for that. He says, sometimes women trade their youth and beauty for children. Men also trade their pursuit of excellence for the sake of stability for the children. So thanks for the super chat. You know, like, before we move on, just real quick, there's a direct correlation between blue skies and sunlight. Wherever there's sunlight, there's often blue skies if there's no clouds in it, right, sort of thing. It's always bright in that sense. And whenever I see a relationship break apart with her leaving him, it's always like, okay, the sun's out, the skies are blue. She's leaving him because of hypergamy. There's like the dots connect. I want to come back to this at another point, though, because I really want to do this show on Robert's book and catching up on what's happening with you guys. But it's interesting that we kind of went down this rabbit hole, because I know that this is a very interesting topic that comes up often. Sean, you got a list of talking points there off the book that you wanted to?
Yeah.
So I got a quiz I got to pass at some point, right?
Yeah, you got a quiz. Let me grab the super chat real quick. Shout out to Dr. Glover and DEF. What's DEFM?
Dating Essentials Format.
Okay.
It's a complicated acronym, but
It's different. Read it in the summer. Since then, been on 36 date, 13 bangs, 7 plates, online only, allows women to choose you, do the work, gentlemen, pick up the book. There you go. There's a great testimonial for his book.
I paid that guy to write that.
Sean, go ahead.
I've recommended this book to three clients, and all three clients have had nothing but great things to say about it. And it's because of that anxiety aspect that you really tackle. All right. So here's my little 3-point quiz. You ready, Robert?
I'm ready.
Okay.
I don't know that I'll pass it, but I'm ready to take it.
That's okay. You quiz me on my book. I won't pass it either. So what's the number one aphrodisiac to women?
Confidence.
There you go. That's number one. Question number two. It's at chapter 14. What's the number one mistake nice guys make with women?
Number one mistake nice guys make
with women. Ooh, I know. Covert contracts.
Rich.
Oh, good guess.
That's a good guess. Trying to please them.
I think in chapter 14, you said not taking the lead.
Okay, good. All right.
You want to talk about that for a minute?
Not taking the, well, you brought that up a couple minutes ago about setting the tone and taking the lead. And this is a challenging piece for a lot of men nowadays, you know, especially with all the, you know, vibe out there, you know, that, you know, women are going to react angrily if you like show up with a plan. But again, I go back to that women being security seeking creatures, and yeah, you know, even kind of referencing back to the whole hypergamy discussion. Yeah, of course they want to feel safe. Of course they want to feel secure, but it's more than just money. It's emotionally, it's connected wise. But in my experience, most women I've ever been around have a hamster wheel going in their head all the time. And when we guys go and
we like to caffeinate the hamster is what we like to say.
Caffeinate the hamster.
Yeah, sometimes it's good to keep the hamster a little caffeinated running on the wheel.
Okay. In my experience, when a guy walks up with the same hamster wheel going,
not good for guys, though,
with all of his anxiety and all, it's not a good thing. I think women like to be with a man that makes them feel good for a few moments, that gets them out of their own hamster wheel, that gets them out of their own small, you know, crazy thinking world. And I think if a man shows up, setting the tone, taking the lead, not going down the woman's rabbit holes with her, and just saying, no, we're going to go have fun. I mean, just an example. Remember, I started dating one woman. I dated her for a while, and she worked at a mall in a clothing store. And we'd often meet at a happy hour, Ruth's Chris bar, you know, right there in the mall. And I'd often get there before her, and she'd come in, and she'd sit down and just start complaining, just wham, 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 customers, management, blah, 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 blah. And I quickly learned, yeah, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole. And I'd get my phone out. I'd say, you're on the clock. You got 5 minutes. Complain away. Complain away. You got my full undivided attention. Decompress from work. I'm here. Alarm goes off in 5 minutes. We're on a date. We're at happy hour. And typically, she'd get through it in 2 or 3 minutes because she didn't really want to be in that place either. But if I didn't set the tone and lead on that, that could have gone on all friggin' night long. So that's just one example of setting the tone and making it more fun and interesting for the woman to be around you instead of the proverbial, what do you want to do? You want to go out? You want to see a movie? Where do you want? You want to go get dinner? Blah. Women tell me they hate that. They just totally hate it.
You said something really cool back in chapter 7, since we're talking about 14 now. You said, don't climb onto her emotional roller coaster. She doesn't want you there.
She does not. I had one girlfriend that, you know, when I'd kind of get a little wrapped up and she'd be in a bad mood and I'd be thinking she's mad at me or something, she'd say, you know, there's only room for one girl in this relationship. And it's me. You know, she'd say, you know, you're so narcissistic. Everything's about you. And I go, well, yeah, you're kind of right about that, but you're okay, right? You're not mad at me. You know, she didn't want me there. She didn't want me trying to make everything better every time she was in a little bit of a pissy mood. That this actually was the same woman. She liked it better when I put her on the clock and said, you got 5 minutes.
So what did that give her that comforted her?
It gave that sense of security again. It created a structure. I don't want to go down, another whole rabbit hole, but the feminine structure, masculine is structure, feminine is everything that's moving in the universe. And, again, we could go for hours around that. But we create a structure that then they can flow in, they can be energetic in. But if there's no structure, it can be all over the place. That's part of men thinking women are complicated. I think a lot of times they're just seeking just some structure that they can be all of themselves, but it's not going every which direction.
Yeah.
And again, we'll never get all this shit completely figured out, and we'll never get it all right. But mm-hmm. but there are some models and paradigms we can use that make it a lot easier.
Mm-hmm. You want question number three?
Do it.
Bring me That's question fun. Number three. Right. I need the third one to get a passing grade because I'm only 50%.
I was just thinking about that. One of the things I hated about all of my 22 years of school or whatever I did is that once you miss a question, you can never get back to 100%. So there's only three questions here and you've already missed one. So you're at a 50%. The best you can do, Robert, is a 66, which is a low D on your own book.
Oh man. fuck the last question. I don't even care.
Okay. Here's question number three. And I think this one is a metaphor for life, but with women, it's fill in the blank. With women, you should get to what quickly?
Rejection.
Yeah.
Why? Boom. Yeah, I knew that one. Get to rejection quickly. We're going back to the whole anxiety thing and the metaphor for life. And even going back to, riches, putting a dent in the universe and the pursuit of excellence. You got to take some chances. You got to get out of your comfort zone. You got to be bold. You got to take some risks. Got to walk through a few open doors and find out, I don't want to go through that door. I'm going to go check out another one. But just the whole playing it safe, nothing interesting's ever going to happen. I tell people one of my personal mantras is I love waking up in the morning not knowing how my day's going to end. And that's really true. I don't want my every single day to go exactly the same and end the same way. So best way I know to practice that is go take some chances and get to rejection quickly. Find out, is this going to work for me or not?
Mm. Where are we at for the points now on this test?
We're at 66.
I
can bring you up to
you got three of the 66s then.
I can bring you up to 75% if you want to take on one more question. This will be a softball.
And that's still just a C, right?
Still just a C. Okay, I'll throw it out there. You can decide. Okay. Chapter 19. What is the most important dating skill of all?
Being a good ender.
Yeah, there you go. Title of the chapter is practice. The title of chapter 19, practice the most important skill of all, be a good ender. What does that mean?
What does that mean? That's right up there with essential life skills. If you look at people that really do well in life, they know when to walk away. They know when to take the sunk cost and move on. So when I got out of, like I said, out of my second marriage, I'm in my late 40s, married to two women for 25 years that I should not have dated either woman more than three dates. That's how bad of a dater I was. It probably goes back to the piece, Rich, you were referring to earlier that, I've said for a long time, men tend to make their relationship choices that the woman's not too bad looking, but not too good looking, pay some attention to him, and at some point's willing to have sex with him. That's kind of the core thing most men make their decisions. Pretty much the basics, yeah. There you go. And that's what I did. And, I thought, okay. And because I didn't know how to date, I never left a woman once I was with her. I just put up with whatever and tried real hard. Mm-hmm. So when I got out of my second marriage, I realized two things. I had to become a better dater or a better picker. And I most importantly had to become a better ender. And I came to the realization that dating is actually a process of making a lot of bad picks. That's what dating is. You should go on a lot of one and done coffee dates. Pick, okay, let's just go give it a try. Nope, not interested. Now that's when you got to be a good ender. Being a good ender can cover a multitude of sins for being a bad picker. You can make a lot of bad picks, but if you realize quickly it's not a good pick and move on quickly, it opens the door for the opportunity to make some better picks along the way.
Yeah. So you can actually say, you don't want me? Good. Let's both move on.
Yeah. Not interested? Good. You're difficult? Good. You know, you're going to flirt with someone else when you're on a date with me? Good. I'm glad I found that out. Let's move on.
How do you recommend guys get over the thirst for the one, like the one that they pine for, the one that they can't let go of, the one that treats them like crap? I mean, it really comes from a lack of options, right?
No, I don't.
Sorry, say that again.
Grow the fuck up. It is. It's an immature. It's a very, very. It's a like a 9-year-old girl behavior to get this crush that you just obsess about somebody. Now, in my experience, most guys that do that,
a lot of guys get it bad though, right? I mean, they just can't get it out of their head.
They do, and in general, they probably have ruminating, obsessive brains anyway. Then they tend to get stuck on things like that, like get stuck on words like hypergamy and stuff like that. You know, and they can't let go of it. So that they do, they get really stuck. And you know, Sean probably can speak to this. I think there must be some psychological, emotional wiring that makes a certain woman just seem to light us up, even if she doesn't know we exist, or even if she thinks we're a douchebag. There's something about that. But the core problem is, if you're just ruminating about anything and not taking action to make it happen, that's my definition of immaturity. I don't care if it's a woman. I don't care if it's, you know, getting an education, getting a good job, getting money in the bank. If you're sitting around fantasizing about something and not taking the action it takes to get there, that's a grow the fuck up question and answer.
Yeah. Rollo has this term that I really like and I've really thought about a lot. It's one-itis, where you have that one woman that's just captivated you and you can't step away from it. And I don't know how to quantify that, but I know it's real because I've been through it. I know so many guys who've been through it. Rich, you've probably been through it. But
a few times. Yeah, I mean, I don't know a single guy that hasn't had one-itis for a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I've been there, done that. I married my second wife for that reason. She's the most beautiful creature that I'd ever seen, and she was interested in me. I mean, what could go wrong there? It's got to be good. The fact that she and I were both married at the time, I mean, that shouldn't have anything to do with the equation. But yeah, it's, and again, I think that it's a combination of some emotional emptiness, some degree of insecurity, some degree of anxiety, some degree of a perception of a lack of options, some degree of maybe watching too much porn. You know, it could be probably a combination of a lot of things. And even culturally, we're bombarded with all that stuff, you know, musically, movies. I mean, I can't think of a worse song than one where a guy's whining about a woman and being obsessed with her. But those are popular.
Yes. It's pretty pathetic. I got a question here.
Go ahead.
Just want to throw this at you guys. It says, my boyfriend, so this is coming from a woman, boyfriend's highly ambitious and I respect his career in AI. I was wondering what I can do, how I can bring more value into his/our lives.
All right.
What would you guys say?
I've got a thought. Sean, do you want to go first? Or
I'll gather my thought while you express your thought.
When I was dating, after I dated a woman a few times, and it looked like we might keep seeing each other, I told her, I'd say, okay, looks like, you know, we're getting along pretty well. We're probably going to keep seeing each other. I would tell her what she could expect from me. And I would tell her four things you can expect from me. I'll be conscious. I'll pay attention to me, to you, to us, to what's going on. I said, I will be honest. Everything I tell you will be the complete truth. You won't ever find out this, I left anything out, or I didn't tell you something important, or I lied to you. I'll be transparent. I'll tell you what I think, what I feel, what I want, what I expect from you, where I'm going. And number four, Sean, going back to that question number two on the quiz, I will show up with a plan. I will set the tone and take the lead. Every woman I told that to, I probably told that to four, five, six different women during, you know, the big span of my dating years. Mm-hmm. Every one of them got a look in their eyes, go, wow. You know, every one of them said, I've never had a man say anything like that to me. You could just see, you know, they were getting wet and saturated in that moment. Mm. And the majority of them, which is a good sign, asked me, okay, what do you expect of me? And I told every one of them, tell me the truth, treat me well, and make my world beautiful. I'd say, I got everything else under control. I got a career. I got guy friends. I can make money. I can travel. I got everything under control. So just treat me well and make my world beautiful. And when you tell a woman that, and she kind of looks up to the side and her wheels are turning, thinking, I can do that. I can. Mm-hmm. I know how to treat him well. I know how to make him, how to make his world beautiful. And I get, you know, maybe it sounds a little bit old fashioned, but it seemed to work well for me and for the women I dated, many of whom were very accomplished women. They liked that idea of, oh, I can think of things to treat him well and make his world beautiful. And so if this guy's got a career and she respects where he's at, yeah, he probably doesn't need a lot more than what she can do to treat him well and make his world beautiful.
I got a second part to that question, but I want to throw it over to you, Sean, before I take it there.
Can you throw the question back up there again?
Yeah, hold on. I got to scroll back up. There it is. Go ahead.
I have a very similar answer. Okay. He's an ambitious guy and she digs that about him. My answer to that question would be become his biggest ally and think about what you can do the thing that to encourage the thing that's working for both of you, which is his ambition, which mm-hmm. makes your relationship better. But she's already doing that. She's already going out into the world saying, hey, how can I be his biggest ally? So keep doing what you're doing.
She's already watching before the train wreck and posting yeah. questions on it. You know, yeah. everybody out there's thinking, how come I don't have a girlfriend like that? This, yeah. you know, wanting to know how to support me in my life.
The toxic feminist will not like my response to it, but it's become a compliment to his life and support his mission is really what it's going to boil down to. I mean, if you plan on making a yeah. career out of this relationship, you know, go all in. Yeah. I wanted to throw this.
I think all three of us said something that all pretty much echoes the same sentiment.
Yeah. I wanted to throw this at you because I was thinking about it as you were talking about it, Robert, when you were kind of diving down your little exploratory rabbit hole, but do you think it's more important to express overtly what your intent is and what your mission and purpose is, or do you think it's more valuable to express it through your actions and your choices and how you know spend your time and resources, or is it a combination of both?
That's a good question, and I don't know that I have like a concrete answer. I would lean towards live your purpose. Mm-hmm. You know, I get feedback from a lot of people and say, "Well, Robert, you know, you're living your purpose. You have a good life. You're making a difference in the world." But I've never once in my lifetime sat down and thought, "What's my purpose?" I just kind of get up and.
But I mean, you got clear at one point when you were dating. You said, "Look, you know, this is who I am. This is where I'm going. Take it or leave it," sort of thing. But I mean, you actually had it as a conversation piece. It's almost like you. It had like a press release to what your intent was versus just in doing it.
Yeah. That was how I was going to show up in relationship. Yeah. And from there they could watch how I show up in the world. I'll give you an example. My wife, I've been married 3 years to Lupita. She's Mexican, does not speak English. So all of our relationships all been, I'm in Mexico. I met her here. It's all been in Spanish. And I did not speak very good Spanish when we met. So I've gotten better over time over the last 5 years. But I think probably for a few years, she had no fucking clue what I did. Mm-hmm. She knew I'd written a book because she actually has been translated into.
Good enough. Let's get married.
So she knew I read a book. But it wasn't till.
Gringo with a book. Let's do it.
Yeah. 2 years ago, I got invited up to Vancouver, BC. To give a talk up there. I gave a talk on a Thursday night to a mixed audience, about 150 people, men and women both. Mm-hmm. And I was all in English, so she couldn't understand most of what I said. But I got done after an hour, hour and a half of speaking in front of an audience, and she just looked at me with tears in her eyes. She said, "You're a really big man. You are really important. There were people just hanging on every word that you said." Mm-hmm. And prior to that time, we were already married. Other than she knew I'd written a book and I work with men, I don't know she had a clue, you know, the technical things that I do sitting on my computer all day long. But she saw how I live my life, right?
Well, women want to be with a giant. They love watching you pursue excellence in front of an audience of admiring men that want to be you.
Well, this was men and women.
And women.
Yeah.
And so, women that want to be with you, right? Of course.
Yeah, of course.
It's going to turn around.
It is a turn on to know that for my woman to know I've got choices. That is a turn on for her as well, to know I've got choices in every area of my life.
And one of the things, Yeah. One of the things I've seen in my practice for, I've worked with a lot of couples for a lot of years now, is that women watch their, when women talk about their man to me, they so often will talk in terms of the behaviors that they've tracked. They're constantly watching us, even though they're very verbally based creatures, more so than us. They're much better at watching behaviors than we are in general. We could learn that from them.
Oh, I agree with that. And again, yeah, it goes back to the kind of going back to dating essentials for men. That's why I'd say teaching guys, you become a social animal. That makes an impression on women. They see you walk in a room. You've got, you know, you got your stature about you. You're calm. You know, they see people noticing you. You know, they see people talking to you and seeking you out, and you know people's names, and you know, they know your name. That stuff, you don't even have to give a, you don't have to tell a woman what you do or what your purpose is. Right. They just see how you walk into a room and own it. And you know, the studies say that women know within about 30 seconds if they're going to sleep with you or not. So it's first 30 seconds that something's activated in them, and it's what they perceive in you, not anything you've told them about what your purpose in life is.
You got a question there, Robert, on the hardcover version of your book. I don't know if you can see it.
Not out in print version yet. We're in just starting the process of that. So hopefully 3 months.
Cool.
But it is out on Kindle.
It's out as an ebook, and it's out on an Audible book as well. So you can listen to it or get it for your Kindle.
Did you read the audiobook yourself?
I did indeed.
Did you as well, Sean?
No.
Yeah, I'm contemplating that because I'm in the final stages of just getting the book edited. I think I'm going to read my own book.
Do it. Do it.
Did you have to go to a studio, or did you just do it from home with a decent mic?
Both times I had contracts, and they brought me back to New York City and studios. While we're on the subject, No More Mr. Nice Guy, they didn't give me the option of reading it. They gave it to a professional voice.
Yeah, you had a voice actor for that one. Yeah.
And so, you know, I after about 15 years, we ended that contract, and I said, I want to read it. I want my voice on it. And the same company that had it came back and gave me a giant advance and $5,000 to get the book back and for me to come to New York and read it. Same thing for Dating Essentials for Men. It was a different company. But still, yeah, they paid me to come read it.
Got it. Okay, good to know. So we got another super chat question here from Edward. He says, does Dr. Glover deny the biochemical nature of relationships? Pair bonding seems more physical in nature than given credit for, especially while young.
I think biochemicals tied into everything that we do. That pair bonding, as far as we know, has only existed less than 10,000 years in human experience. And not being pair bonded, i.e. being part of a tribe where everything's communal, seems to have been the experience for 1.5 to 2 million years. Compare those two parts of time, and that's why the pair bonding still does not work very well. And my theory is that most of us are trying to get all of our tribal needs met, food, companionship, sex, everything that we would get in a group. We're trying to get it all met in one person. The opposite sex.
That's one of the things I've heard Esther Perel say a number of times.
Love Esther Perel. Highly recommend her stuff.
We got somebody waiting to join in and ask a question. Mark, you'd be next. Did you want to continue with the quiz, or do you want to throw in Mark and see what he's got to say?
I can raise my grade. Did I hear that?
Let me see if I can scrounge up another question here while Mark's talking.
All right, let me throw Mark onto the stream. You're on, Mark. You got a question for us or something that you disagree with?
Oh, no, I don't disagree. I do have a question. I've been listening to you guys for a while on the various shows. And my thing is, I agree with a lot of the stuff. I'm learning, but I'm a little older. So I don't know if it's worth me trying to spin plates at this age.
How old are you?
I'm 59, but you know, most people say I don't look it. And I stay in shape. I'm a musician. I'm kind of like a recording artist. I do a lot of things. But I was married for 29 years and just got a divorce a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. The problem that I'm having and I'm stuck at is that I met a girl as I was transitioning from the marriage with really no downtime. And she was great. She was everything I needed at the time. I spent maybe 3 years with her now. Mm-hmm. But I've been trying to break away from her. And because of that, it's in the back of my mind every day that I need to have some time on my own, spin plates, but also get to know myself, all those things that therapists tell you to do after a long marriage. And so I'm basically been breaking up with her, and I just broke up again. And my only, you know, second thoughts are, is the age factor, you know, is it, you know, I'm kidding. I'm almost 60. How much time do I have left to really do this kind of thing?
Well, Robert, you're doing a lot of dating in that age range, around 50 or so.
I'm 64 as we talk. My wife is 22 years younger than me. I'm really immature, so I get along well with younger women. You know, the deal is I've never.
So am I.
Good. That helps. Yeah. I've never chased younger women, but the majority of women who tend to seek me out and approach me and send me signals of interest are significantly younger. And I mentioned my wife's Mexican, so she's the typical jealous Latina. And she is always pointing out women who are trying to get my attention. And I promise you, all of them, you know, all of them are significantly younger than me. So this is one of the self-limiting beliefs a lot of us men have, is that our value goes down to women as we get older. Now, to me, the beauty of getting older as a guy is that there's more and more younger women. That's just, you know, that's a mathematical fact. So I'd say challenge that self-limiting belief. Don't go chase younger women, but go out and live the kind of great life we've all been talking about. And I promise you, most women from 10 to 15 to 20 to 25 years younger than you tend to be bored with the men their age, and they like an older man who's experienced in life, who's got confidence, and who can, again, get them out of their hamster wheel.
Well, to be honest, a 45-year-old looks good at me right now. You know, the older you get, it's like
they're all younger. That's
So I don't think I don't mind. I'm not trying to go for the real young, but I just feel like I might have given up one that was really great, but I happened to meet her at the wrong time. You know, I really feel like I have to be on my own for a while.
Well, go. I support you. Go do the things you've got to do. I had to do that as well.
Well, you know, I appreciate it. Hey, Rich, I really enjoy your show. All you guys, thanks for, you've really helped me out a lot.
Yeah, thanks, Mark.
All right, man. Y'all guys, take care.
See you, brother. All right. So we're on for another 20-odd minutes or so, 20, 25 minutes. If you guys have questions, something you agree with, you disagree with, you want to challenge us on, I'll post the link again. You want to hop on soon because we're not going to be on all night. Did you find that next pop quiz question, Sean?
Another pop quiz question.
You can raise your score to an 80, Robert. This is another fill in the blank.
That's still just a B.
That's okay. That's better than where you were. The more power you give a woman to make you happy, the more power you give her to make you what?
Miserable.
Explain.
Unhappy. Well, it's a whole external validation thing, that if we get our sense of value and well-being from the things outside of us, I mean, that's a fucking roller coaster ride. When things are going well, we're good. When things are going not so well outside of us, we're bad. And it's, you know, there's a lot of terms in it in psychology. You probably know more of them than I do, but external locus of control, you know, just everything that has to do with getting your sense of self externally is going to bite you on the ass. So, you know, going back to Rich's question about these, you know, these women that we get obsessed with, I promise you, if you're a guy and you're obsessed with some particular woman, that woman is going to make you more miserable than happy, in however long you stay obsessed with her.
Yeah, obsession for any one woman is a really bad idea. Obsession for any one thing really is a bad idea, if I'm being honest, but especially with women, because a lot of guys rely on that obsession to, like, it's almost like oxygen in their lungs. And when you take it away from them, they have a hard time dealing with it. Like, they can't breathe, sort of thing. Sean, do you have any other quiz points there?
I can come up with another one, but I had a question for you, Rich.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I wondered what your answer was to your question that you asked earlier about how much do you discuss your plans versus how much do you just follow your plans?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So that's a good one. So my preference is to demonstrate rather than to overtly state it. Because, I mean, by the time you have to make an overt statement to it, it's almost like you're at a position of powerlessness. You're almost at a declaration of, okay, she's not paying attention to my lead and my direction where I'm going. So now I have to sit down and explain what it is. And I don't think women value that as much as watching you do it rather than you having to explain why you do it sort of thing. Yeah. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can think of one situation where it might be powerful to explain. I agree with you, Rich, 100%. But if a woman is being a woman and working against her own best interest, and like working against you in the direction you're going, like, oh, can't you just spend some more time with me? Or do you really have to go spend time with your guy friends? Or do you really have to go speak at that conference? And they're like working against it because, you know, emotionally they want the connection. They want you there. Sometimes you do have to explain that. No, I hear you, baby. You know, I love being with you, but this is what I do. This is what makes me me. And is what makes you love me and be attracted to me. And if I ever quit doing that, you're going to quit having that attraction. So yes, I do have to go do this. So sometimes it does have to be explained to them why you have to stay on purpose.
Mm. I just want to caution guys to make sure that they avoid putting themselves in a position where they get out the whiteboard and they start drawing things out for their wife or girlfriend. Like, this is how things are going to be, baby, sort of thing. That's never a good position to put yourself in. Sean, while you're going to the next question, I just have to take a quick minute here and just shout out to the channel sponsor. So let me just go full screen here. Tactical Soap, Scott from Grondyke Soap. Guys, you're showering anyway. It's linked in the ticker below. It's the channel sponsor. They got a fantastic all-natural beard oil and soap product. It's all handmade in the States. Check out with coupon code Cooper. Actually, you don't even need to check out with coupon code Cooper. Scott was telling me that if you go to coopersoap.com, it's already applied. Or if you go to the link below pinned, you might be prompted to enter the code there. But check that out. And also, I want to introduce you guys to got a couple callers here that will join on in a second. I want to introduce you guys to another sponsor I've just had a chat with. I've been using this new body stuff, and it's all under alphafit.fit, which is also pinned in the top comment. You can see it in the ticker, alphafit.fit. There it is. Yeah. They've got all kinds of products around self-care. We've got creatine, energy products, and regularity products, but I'm not going to talk about regularity products because you guys should be pretty regular. Are you? If you're not, anyway, this is the stuff over here that I've really been digging lately. I got jokes tonight, guys. This is the stuff that I've been using regularly, and I'm going to tell you why this stuff is amazing. I've never used anything like this before. It expands to something like 50 times its capsule size when it opens up in your stomach. It's basically a fiber that just fills you up, and it has no calories whatsoever. So helps with the crappage, of course, but most importantly, if you're trying to cut down and lose some body fat, stuff works. I've been using it before I go do my cardio at the dojo. And I'm telling you, for the last 2 months, I've cut close to 10 pounds, but I'm still working on getting down a little bit more. Who should we go to here first? Do you want to throw that next question at him, Sean, before we go to the callers? Or do you want to do callers?
Sure. I'll throw a quick question out there. And this one's kind of our
up its score.
Yeah.
I'm feeling more pressure now. When I was playing from behind, you know, I had nothing.
We'll go over to the callers after this last one, just so we don't beat you up too bad, Jay, on this.
Well, this one's kind of arcane, so I won't fault you if you don't get it. And it was one of those lines that I thought was kind of funny in your book, but contains a great deal of truth to it. And it comes out of chapter 7, and it's myth number 3, where you list the myths that guys buy into that get them in trouble. And the myth number 3 is that women are naturally good at relationships. And as you were discussing the, you know, putting the lie to that, you said, if you put 3 women in a room, what will happen?
One of them is going to leave with her feelings hurt.
Right. So, as evidence that women are not experts at relationships any more than we are, and we don't need to be intimidated by that.
If they were experts, they wouldn't have to listen to so much Oprah and Dr. Phil and buy so many books on it, and they'd get along with each other. You know
why guys think that women are the experts is because they automatically defer to the feminine, because women are watching all this crap on TV, and then they're coming home and they're like, that's not the way that it goes, Robert. This is how it needs to be. And you're like, okay, she has a vagina, so I'll listen to her.
Exactly. I want to get laid, so you know, I'll do it her way. Yeah, that doesn't serve us. And that goes back to setting the tone and taking the lead. That, you know, just quickly, Sean, you mentioned, you know, the couples one person dragging the other person into couples counseling. When I started 25, 30 years ago, it was almost always the woman dragging the man into couples counseling. By the time I quit private practice 6-7 years ago, it was almost always the men driving the women, dragging the women into couples counseling. So there's been a significant shift culturally of men actually showing up. And even all the stuff we're talking about, even before this is about how men can actually work in conscious ways to improve the chances of creating healthy relationships that are satisfying for them and their partner and maintaining them over time. So I'm thrilled that men are actually interested in setting the tone and taking the lead in this way.
All right. James, what's up, brother?
How are you guys doing?
Good. Doing good. You have a question or a challenge you want to throw at us?
All right. Yeah. So my question is about a conversation that Rich and I had previously, and then I put on his 1% discussion board in the men's group. So I am, answering the questions we get asked quickly. I'm 32, married to a 35-year-old. We've been married just over 5 years. We've got a 3.5-year-old and a 1.5-year-old. So what we have been dealing with is we started having some disagreements, and that escalated to domestic violence within the relationship. So far, there have been 5 incidents, all of them her against me. So Dr. Smith or Sean, when you brought it up before, the stuff you talked about in your 15-minute video about how to handle that has helped me out tremendously. I've actually cited everything that you talked about when I've had to file police reports. But what happens is I come back, and then we have we make up. We continue to try to work on the relationship. I have taken her to counseling to try to set the tone of the relationship, as Dr. Glover's talked about. But that has continued to happen. Like I said, 5 instances at this point. My question is, from your perspective, at what point do I grow the fuck up, as Dr. Glover said, and just say, I'm ending this? And at what point is it worth continuing to put effort into the relationship for the sake of keeping my family together for the kids?
Is she continuing to put effort into the relationship?
Yes.
Do you get the sense that she's honestly trying to tackle this?
Yes.
You got a safety plan, and have you talked to an attorney in your particular municipality, not someone in somewhere else?
Yes, I've talked to an attorney. The attorney says that I should get out.
I'm kind of curious what Robert would say about this, because you've heard a lot of these stories.
Well, I like your question, Sean. You know, is she working on it? I've never seen a perfect relationship, and I've never been in a perfect relationship. My bottom line is, are both people willing to work on their shit? And that's what, to me, relationships do. They're powerful personal growth machines. Now, there does have to be limits, though, very clear limits. Limits, I think you have to have the limits around, telling the truth, limits around fidelity, limits around physical hitting. Every couple's got to figure out what those limits are. And I think it has to be really clear that those limits don't get crossed. And if they do get crossed, that is the end. And I get it's challenging to walk away from someone you care about. I've been there. Like I said, terrible ender. But setting boundaries is not about getting other people to be different. It's about getting you to be different. And the only power you have to set a boundary is a willingness and ability to remove yourself. And you can let your woman know how much you love her, but let her know there are certain behaviors that will not be tolerated.
James, have you seen an improvement, or is she still having the outbursts?
I've seen an improvement. There has not been her actually physically contacting me since Thanksgiving. The last outburst she had, she was angry at me for not asking enough questions about why she was upset on a particular day. And so she took off her wedding ring and threw it at the wall, and then took down all of our family pictures, but she didn't touch me again.
How long ago was that?
Last week.
That's still kind of a hissy fit. It's just moving from her having a physical outburst on you to her taking the ring and whipping it against the wall and taking down pictures. Like, this is something, like, Sean, this is something that you've talked about with hissy fits before, and a little bit of a lack of maturity in dealing with, conflict in that sense. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, I'm with Robert. At some point, you got to end it. But if you're saying that she's making progress, I'm always for giving the people a chance to improve. The thing that sucks about this kind of situation, I'm gathering this about you, is that if it were the other way around and you were the one getting physical, there would be a very specific plan imposed by the state for you to maintain contact with your children, right? Because that's how it works. Doesn't work that way with women, I'm gathering. She has, she has not had this plan imposed upon her?
She has not.
Okay.
I have not pressed charges. I filled out police reports. I did not press charges. The last time they offered a civil protection order, if I wanted to separate her from me and the children, and I showed that to her, and that I think is why there's been a marked change in behavior when she found out that I, at that point, I can't do it anymore because civil protection orders really have to be fairly close to the incident. But at that point, she found out that they were willing to separate her from the kids, and I think that changed her perspective.
Good. And if it were the other way around, you were the abuser, then the state would have pressed charges on her behalf, right? So
I would be in jail. I'm confident. Yeah.
So if you're, you know, I never give specific advice. You got to do what you got to do. But it, one way to think about it is that if she's going to continue to make progress, she has to have something that she's aiming for. She has to have a target that she's shooting for. And so you could play real hardball here and say that what I need to see is not an absence of behavior. Not like I don't need to see you not hitting me and not throwing things. What I need to see is the things that we talked about in counseling or whatever, where when you get angry, you're going to do X, Y, and Z, positive behaviors. And if I don't see that, then I start looking at pressing charges. But I don't want to do that. I want us to succeed and I want you to succeed. So this is the plan. You're going to follow it or this is going to happen. But I want you to succeed. You know, so that's one option. If you do want to stay with her, is that you lay down the law in terms of what needs to happen next, so she knows what she's supposed to do.
Hey, James, let me ask you this question. So, if you know, if the worst was her with the physical issues, you know, in the past, and that's stopped since October, has the hissy fits replaced it? Is it not as bad? Like, what does it look like from your perspective? I mean, you're the guy living in this day in, day out. Like, are the hissy fits throwing rings against walls and taking down pictures any better or worse? Or where's that at from your perspective?
No, that seems fairly constant.
It's pretty constant, eh?
Right. And that's the kind of thing that can flare back up and escalate at any point. You know, this sort of behavior is very hard to extinguish. Dogs aren't people, but people are dogs. People and dogs have similarities where if you train a behavior out of a dog, at some point the behavior flares back up and you don't know why. And same thing happens with people. So that's why there needs to be the plan of what she needs to do, not what she doesn't need to do, if that makes sense.
Yeah. I got a little more reference around this because James and I talked for an hour not too long ago, but I feel for you, bro. It's like one of those things where you're trying to do, like, you know, the right thing, and you got little kids and you got the state against you, and you know, you're doing it, like, you're going about it the right way, but there's going to have to come a point for you as a man where you're going to decide, you know, is this the way that I want to live the rest of my life? Like, is this something that I want to continue to do? Like, am I going to continue to try to appease this unhappy person to try to make them happy? Like, is this going to be my life mission to basically do that? Are you gentlemen familiar with, I think her name's Mira Kirschenbaum, and there's a book called Too Bad to Stay and Too Good to Leave. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I've heard of it, but I've not read it.
Have you read it, Sean?
No, I haven't.
I read it a long time ago when I was looking at my divorce. If you haven't read it, it'll kind of walk you through some exercises and share some stories for you that you might find useful. I'd read it in front of her, you know, to be honest with you, just to let her know that you're fucking serious. Mm-hmm. But go through that, you know, make some notes in the book. I found it really useful when I went through it. It's kind of like a choose your own adventure. It's just, you know, you basically decide from a series of stories that you're going through whether or not this is something that you want to carry on with and if that's the kind of life that you want to live.
Now, what was the name of that again?
I think the author is Mira Kirschenbaum, but if you search the title, Too Bad to Stay, Too Good to Leave, it should come up.
I'll do that.
Okay. Can I ask one quick question? Is your wife in therapy specifically around anger outbursts, and is she learning strategies and plans for dealing with her intense emotions differently?
I requested pretty firmly that she go and seek individual therapy. So far, she's had one session. I do not know what they talked about.
Okay. I will be real direct. I won't tell you to leave your wife, but I'll be really, this is you setting the tone and taking the lead and giving your relationship a chance. This is where you lead. You tell her to stay, in order for you to stay with me, you have to be in therapy or a program directed at anger management and directed at teaching you tools for dealing with your intense emotions more effectively. Because just her trying to work on herself will not change it. It will not. I've never seen it happen. And people, you just got to be that clear. If you want to stay with me, this is the work you have to do to stay with me. And tell her, I support you on it. I'll encourage you. I'll work on myself in all of this. But this is non-negotiable. You be in a program directed towards your anger, and you do the work. And you know, this goes back to what Sean was saying. She's got positive things to be working toward. And if she won't do it, you have no hope of this ever changing, period. Prayer won't change it. Miracles won't change it. Antidepressants won't change it. For a 35-year-old woman to be throwing that kind of 4-year-old hissy fits on a regular basis, I get you may not be easy to live with either. But that's still no excuse for a person doing those kinds of behaviors. There's no excuse for it, for an adult to be acting that way. And I get she probably has trauma. She probably is stressed out from having young kids. And she's got to get resources and learn how to deal with it.
Does that help, James?
It does. Can I ask one more question for the doctors here? From a risk assessment standpoint, if you were, you don't know my wife, you don't have any emotional investment in my relationship, from a risk assessment standpoint, the likelihood of another outburst like this is very high. I followed your advice. I've raised my hands. I've gone towards the door. I've gotten the phone out held it so that it was out of reach, but had my hands up. She has done everything that you said that would happen, physically blocking the door to the point of laying down in front of a door so that I can't leave. These things are likely to come up again. From a strictly risk assessment standpoint, a single domestic violence incident against me will make it so that I'll lose access to my firearm, I'll lose access to a lot of things. I'll lose ability to travel. I'll lose ability to have control of my children. May well lose access to my children. Do you have any tools or any recommendations for a risk assessment strategy for something like this?
You are already at risk. I assume the next time we talk to you, you have already been to jail. Not because you're a bad person, but you will be. Because as Sean's already indicated, if most states, if they get a domestic violence call, they got to arrest somebody. And if you were the one that like pushed her out of the way to get out a door, or if you did anything, if she tells them you did anything, they have to believe her. And you will go to jail. So in a sense, that's really the biggest decision you've got to make here is, do you want to go to jail?
One of the biggest sound bites that stood out for me from that book that I recommended to you a few moments ago, James, was if your entire marriage, if your entire relationship feels like you're walking headlong into a hurricane type force wind. And I don't know if you ever walked in, like headwards into hurricane style winds. I mean, I did it once in the Caribbean. I think it was one of the lower categories. It wasn't like a really bad one where you had to evacuate, but literally trying to walk from one building to the other, it would normally take 30 seconds. It'd take like about 10 minutes because you're walking headlong in a hard ass wind. And if your entire relationship feels like that and you're constantly doing that, my advice would be get the fuck out. It's just, how do you untie that knot and, pick up, clean up all the pieces that you're kind of going through, but
Let me throw an option out there. I'll throw an option out there, and it's something to run past an attorney. I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know how these things work, obviously, but one possibility might be that you create that physical separation between you two so that you dramatically lower your risk of being falsely accused. And then she has to earn her way back into your life using some of the things that Robert just talked about.
James Conk's in the community page too, so he's just looking out for you. He's been aware of some of the posts that you've put up as well, so he's just pointing that out.
So one last question for you. You have some guys around you, I take it. You're not isolated with this and just getting into your head and losing perspective.
That's correct.
Okay, good.
All right, James. Hopefully things get better for
you. Thank you very much for your time,
gentlemen. Best, man.
Yep. All right. And with that being said, we're out of time. We're at the 90 minute mark. We're slightly over. So apologize to those guys that are waiting in the area to hop in and ask a question. But this is, again, always, gentlemen, why I say hop on early so you can get a chance to ask those questions. But how did Dr. Glover do on the test, Sean?
I think we ended up, if my math is right, with an 83 and a third. So that's not bad.
A good solid B. All right. All right.
Pretty good for the guy that wrote the book. That's awesome. Yeah. Any closing thoughts or comments, Dr. Glover, for the audience watching tonight? You know, the show's before the train wreck. We try to help guys avoid train wrecks in their lives. You know, you've obviously lived through a few yourself and had to clean up the mess. I do get quite messy. You've written some books based on your experiences. Again, those are all linked in the Amazon store below in the pinned comment. Closing thoughts, comments, remarks to the gentleman?
Oh, man. I've been throwing out all my best stuff. I'd say go back to, you know, let's go back to Sean's thing about anxiety. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, learning to soothe, calm your anxiety, learning to take action even when you feel anxious, those are the things that are going to get you ahead in life and get you what you want. So anything you can do to learn to soothe and I don't want to use the word manage, but soothe anxiety and learn to take actions that scare you, your life's going to get better.
There you have it, guys. Anxiety sucks. Well, Dr. Smith, you're the anxiety expert too, aren't you? Do you have any closing thoughts on that?
I can't add to that. Go after the thing that scares you.
Yeah.
The thing that scares you. I love that. All right. We are back. On the 20th would be the next one. Sean, you're on for that?
23rd. Now that we're going to talk about rites of passage with Mr. Conk. Is that correct?
23rd. Is that when we have him?
No, sorry, 20th. You're right. It's the 20th of January.
Yes. Yes, we do have that in the calendar. So we've got Conk joining us for that one. That'll be fun. I really like him when we get him on. So tune in for that. That's in 2 weeks' time. Robert, thanks for joining us tonight, man. I really appreciate you taking some time out of your schedule to hop on and have a chat. Your enlightenment is always fun.
I always have fun talking to you guys. Thanks for the invitation.
It was great chatting with you tonight, Robert.
All right, guys. See you in the next broadcast. Peace.